Can you try to go? Are you in full screen?
Not yet. Okay.
Yeah, looks perfect.
Okay, now we are live streaming. What did you say, Julien? 5 or 5 something?
I think you say 502.
502 or something. Yeah. Okay, so let's wait the 2 minutes.
No, it is 502 now.
It is 502, okay. It's 5 in my, okay. Okay, welcome everybody back. We welcome to the second talk given by Benedict Haas about distributional properties of the stable graphs.
Okay, so thank you, Nina. Thank you, Julien, for the organization and for this nice opportunity to give this double talk with Christina. I think it's very welcome on this topic. So my goal, my talk is really in the continuation of Christina's one, but I will do some reminders so that people who didn't attend Christina's can, understand most of my talk too. And I will focus on the stable graph, which are the scaling limit that Christina introduced. These are the scaling limit of this critical graph with a IID degree. And my main goal is, I mean, it's quite simple. I just want to understand better how this graph looks like. So, I'll start with a quick reminders on Christina's talk. So starting in the discrete world, we start with n random variable, d1, d2, dn, that IID on the set of positive integers. We assume that they have a second finite moment and that we exclude the particular case where they are equal to 2 with probability 1. Okay. And then given this random variable, we consider a graph GN, which is uniformly distributed on the set of graphs with N vertices, which are labeled 1 to N, and which have respective degrees D1, D2, Dn. So such graph may not exist, but one condition, as Christina said, is that the sum of the Di is even. And if it's not the case, we simply add 1 to the degree dn. But there are other conditions for this graph to exist. And it's possible to show that at least they exist with a probability that tends to 1 when n tends to infinity. Okay. So we consider this graph gn. And there is this very nice result by Molow and Reed, which said that there is a phase transition. So I didn't write it exactly as Christina, but there is a phase transition. And we know that there is a giant component, so a connected component with a size which is proportional to n, if and only if the second moment is strictly larger than 2 times the first moment. Okay, and in this case, the giant component is unique. So in this talk, we will place ourselves in the, at the point where this giant component emerges in the critical case. And so we assume that we have this identity of this, the second moment is equal to 2 times the first moment. And we will consider 2 cases. The first case where the third moment of our degree distribution is finite, and the case where the probability distribution of this degree behaves asymptotically as a power function, so proportionally to k to the power minus alpha plus 2, where alpha is a parameter between 1 and 2. And in some sense, the first case with a finite third moment is a border case, and we will consider that it corresponds to the case where alpha is equal to 2. Okay, so we have this family of a discrete random graph GN, which is indexed by a parameter alpha between 1 and 2, 2 included. And Christina and Guillaume Conchon-Kerjean studied their scaling limits. So that was the main result stated by Christina. So let me recall it. We have our graph GN. We denote by C1n, C2n, etc., its connected component, which are listed in decreasing order of size. And to each of these connected components, we associate its counting measure, which is denoted by mu I n for the ith component. Okay. And then we consider this metric measure space. And the result of Guillaume and Christina said that correctly rescaled. So you have to rescale the distance in the graph by n to the power alpha minus 1 over alpha plus 1. And you have to rescale the measure by n to the power alpha over alpha plus 1 to observe something non-trivial in the limit. And so they prove that this rescaled graph converges. So for the Gromov-Hausdorff-Prokhorov topology, towards a continuous graph, which is called the alpha stable graph. And so this alpha stable graph is represented as a collection, a sequence of connected components, which we denote by Ci mu I. Okay, it's the same notation as Christina. Okay, so we are interested in this limiting object. And Christina has presented us a construction of this object from a thin Levy process, from a thin alpha stable Levy process, which is completely explicit and very nice, but maybe a bit obscure. And my goal is to present, to give some information on this limited connected component, which are I would say a bit more comprehensible. And also, I think part of the information are completely accessible to people that don't know anything about Levy process and stable trees. But of course, these objects are there, and it's by working on these objects that we will obtain this information. Okay. Okay, so Christina gave a lot of references on papers that are related to this result. I won't go into this detail. I also list some of them there, but Christina presented them in detail. And let me just say that in the case where alpha equal 2, we will call the Brownian graph this limit alpha stable graph. And this Brownian graph is already very well known and has been well studied. Partly by Christina and co-author, as it arrives as the scaling limit of various discrete models. Okay, so here is a simulation that was done by Delphin Senitzerg. So I think I forgot to say it, but this the result I present there were obtained with Christina and Delphin. And Delphin did all the simulation. So this is a simulation of a connected component of our alpha stable graph. And that's the object we would like to understand better. So as you can see on this simulation, we can interpret this object as a cycle structure, which is represented in the black stuff, on which are glued continuous trees. Okay, so one of my goal will be to describe the distribution of this cycle structure and the trees that are glued on it. So before that, I prepared two slides that recall some information on a stable tree. Maybe I will go quite quickly on this because many people already know everything, and also because Christina did the same reminders in her talk. One thing I forgot to say recalled the Guillaume and Christina's result is that I didn't take the same normalization as Christina in her talk. I mean that the graph here that appears in the limit, the Ci mu I, is the same as Christina up to a scaling, multiplicating scaling constant, okay. Just two. And it's the same for the alpha stable tree that I will introduce. It's not the same version as Christina. It's Christina's version up to a multiplying scaling constant. Okay. So very quickly, the stable trees can be introduced as the scaling limit of Galton-Watson trees with an offspring distribution with mean one and an offspring distribution which is in the domain of attraction of a stable law. Okay. And then a result by Aldous, Duquesne, relying on result also of Le Gall and Le Jean, describe the asymptotic behavior of this Galton-Watson tree conditioned to have a total number of vertices equal to n. And the scaling limit is called the alpha stable tree. So these trees appears in many models in probability. They are used in the domain of random maps, in fragmentation, coalescence processes. Okay, these are very important models in probability theory, and for this reason, they have been very well studied. And so I recalled some information that will be useful to us to study the alpha stable graph. For example, these are fractal structure, and we know their host of dimension, which is equal to alpha over alpha minus one, almost surely. So you can see that this host of dimension increase as alpha decreases. Okay, so it's and in some sense, you can observe this also on Igor Skorzhensky simulation. And when alpha is smaller, the tree is more dense. And one result that Christina also recalled quickly, and I will spend maybe a bit more time, is a construction of this tree by hand, by gluing segments one on the other recursively. In order to obtain these trees in the limit. And one of the goals of my talk is to present a similar construction for the alpha stable graph. Okay. So let me just recall quickly Aldous' line-breaking construction of the Brownian tree. So we consider a Poisson point process on R plus with intensity TDT. Okay, so it's represented there. And from this Poisson point process, we will construct a sequence of continuous tree recursively. So the first tree is simply a closed segment, to one. It's a closed segment of length R1. And then we pick a point uniformly on this closed segment, and we glue a new closed segment on this selected point, the new closed segment having length R2 minus R1, okay? And once we have this tree, which we call Tau2, we pick again a point uniformly at random on the whole tree. So uniformly means according to the Lebesgue measure on these two glue segments. And once we have picked a new point, we glue on them a new segment of length R3 minus R2. And so on. And we obtain then a growing sequence of tree tau p. And if you take their union, the closure of their union, you obtain a version of the Brownian tree of Aldous. More precisely, so the Brownian tree with my notation is a two stable tree. So as I have presented them, we obtain a version of square root of two times this tree T2. And some years ago with Christina, we presented a similar construction for any alpha stable tree. So for any alpha between one and two, but it is a bit more complicated to present. And actually it will be a particular case of the line breaking construction that I will present for the alpha stable graph. So I will recall it in detail later. Okay, so let's go back to our alpha stable graph and so to its connected component. I need some vocabulary coming from the discrete world. So let's start with this, introducing the notion of surplus. So when you have a connected discrete graph G, the surplus of this graph is the number of edges minus the number of vertices plus one. So if you have a tree, the surplus is zero. And this surplus represents, in some sense, the number of edges more than a tree, which means that it is the minimal number of edges that you have to remove to get a tree from your graph. Okay. So now if we consider the critical random graph Gn and its connected component Cin, and we consider the associated sequences of surpluses, so S, Cin. From Guillaume and Christina's theorem, we know that the sequence of surpluses converges to a sequence of random integer, positive integer, SCI, which we also name the surplus of the limiting connected component. And as Christina presented in one of her last slides, this quantity SCI is the number of vertex identification that we do in the biased version of the alpha stable graph, which is from which she constructs this the connected component. Okay, so this is very vague and not clear, but just to introduce this quantity. And again, from their theorem, we know that the connected component, in some sense, are IID. So this is not exactly the case, but given their surplus, their surpluses and their mass, so the sequence SCI, UICI, so given this quantity, the connected component of the alpha stable graph are independent. And their distribution is entirely given by a sequence that I denote GS mu S, where S belongs to Z plus and represents the surplus. Mu S here is a probability on the leaf of GS. So the distribution of the connected component is entirely given by this sequence in the sense that the East component its distribution is given by a rescaling of the component GS mu S when CI has surplus S. I'm not sure it's clear, but it's written clearly here. The rescaling only depends on the mass of the connected component. So in some sense, it's sufficient to describe the distributional property of this sequence of this GS mu S to have the whole description of the alpha stable graph. Okay, so my goal in the following is to concentrate on such a normalized connected component of the alpha stable graph with surplus S that I will denote GS. Okay, so this is from now on my main object is a connected component of the alpha stable graph with surpluses. And that's the object I would like to describe. Okay, so let me just say that all the results I will present have similar counterparts in the alpha equal two case for the Brownian graph. And this was done in a work by Adario Berri, Broutin, and Goldschmidt. Okay, so we will get here like the heavy tail counterpart of their result. Okay, so we want to describe this graph GS. So for S equals zero, when there is no surplus, this graph is simply the alpha stable tree. So it's an object we already know very well, and well, there is nothing to add there. But for S larger than one, GS has a more complex structure. We know from Christina's result that it's built from a biased version of the alpha stable tree, and the way it's biased, it's a bit, well, complicated. And when we have this biased version of the alpha stable tree, we pick some leaves in some sense, S leaves, and we glue them along their path to the root of the alpha stable tree to get GS. Okay, so this is a bit unclear, said like this, and my goal again is to present now more clearly some property of GS. Let me just say that since it is constructed from a absolutely continuous version of the alpha stable tree, its off-door dimension is the same as the alpha stable tree. So it's alpha over alpha n minus 1. So this is a direct consequence of the construction. So to understand better the structure of this graph GS, we'll use a classical way to describe a random object. We will describe its finite dimensional distribution. So what does it mean here? Here we have a graph with a sickle structure, which we call the kernel. I will define it precisely in 2 seconds. So we have a graph with a cycle structure on which are glued random trees. So our first goal will be to describe the distribution of this cycle structure, the kernel. So let me just define it clearly. So we'll have a continuous version and a discrete version of the kernel. So in your, so here it's there is a representation of the normalized connected component GS. So all the simulation in my talk from now on were done by Delphin Senitzerk. So I didn't wrote it, but I say it. He did the simulation. So here we have a simulation of GS where we surplus two leaves have been glued along their path to the root. Rho represents the root, okay? And the kernel is simply the image obtained after gluing of these two leaves along their path to the root. And more generally, the kernel is the image obtained after the gluing of the S leaves along their path to the root in the construction of Guillaume and Christina. Okay. So we have this continuous kernel. This may be seen as a multiple graph, multigraph with random lengths. And so we will call the discrete kernel the underlying multigraph, forgetting the length. And to describe the distribution of the continuous kernel, we will start by describing the distribution of the discrete kernel and then the distribution of the random lengths we have to put on its edges. So we start from this kernel, and then we will more generally describe the distribution of the finite dimensional distribution. So what do I mean by that? Once I have the kernel, I will pick a sample of IID leaves in the graph GS. So these leaves are distributing according to the natural uniform distribution on this graph, which we call mu s. And from this leaf, we will consider the marginal, so the nth marginal, g and s, is simply obtained by considering the union of the kernel, ks, and the path from the s and first leaf to the root. So here on the simulation, you can see on the left, S1 obtained by considering the union of the kernel and the first leaf, the path from the first leaf to the root, and then GS2, GS3, and so on. Okay. The whole graph will be obtained as a closure of the union of its marginal. So having the distribution of the marginal gives the distribution of the graph in some sense. So my goal is really now to describe the distribution of this object GS1. And I will also, I will also consider their discrete counterpart. Okay, so with, the right G and SN, which is the rooted multigraph, which is associated to the calligraphic GSN. Say differently, it's just the continuous nth marginal minus the edge length. Okay, so if you look at this picture, I'm sorry, I do not have anything to point on the picture, but the picture here of GS3, okay, and you consider here its discrete version and the example on the top of the slide. So this discrete marginal lives in the set denoted MS1. So this is a set of rooted multigraph which have n plus 1 label leaves, a surplus S, and no vertices of degree 2. Okay, and the internal vertices are not labeled in this case. And since we work with rooted graph, we will always consider that the leaf 0 corresponds to the root, right? So for example, the set M2, 0, so we have surplus 2, and here n, the number of leaves we have picked, is 0, so it corresponds to the kernel. Well, it's easy to see that it is composed of seven elements, which are pictured there. Okay. Okay, so let's start with the distribution of the discrete marginal, GSN. So this is our first result. So for any connected multigraph in this set MSN, the distribution of the nth marginal with surplus S is given by this formula. So it's proportional to this quotient. So let me explain what happens in this formula. So on the numerator is given by a product of weight, which are given above, the weight W, okay? And the product is indices by the internal vertices of the graph. And then we divide this product of weight by some quantities. So let me introduce the quantity we observe there. So the symmetry of G, how can we say? It's a symmetry of G is a permutation of the internal vertices that do not change the adjacent relations and the multiplicity of the edge. So for example, if you take here the graph which is among the seven elements of M20, the graph which is on the right, okay, it has two symmetries, the identity of course, and the one where you permute the two vertices that are on the top. Okay, this will not change your graph. So we divide our quantity by the number of symmetry of the graph, by two times the number of self-loop of the graph, so SLG is the number of self-loops, and by the product of the factorial of the multiplicity of the edge. Okay. So this formula complete some formula that were already known. For example, when there is no surplus, when S is equal to zero, we retrieve the distribution of the marginal of the alpha stable tree that was obtained by Duquesne and Le Gall. When you take any S but alpha equal to 2, so when we are in the Brownian case, we retrieve the distribution of the marginal of the Brownian graph that was obtained in different form in the paper by Adario Berry, Bruton, Goldschmidt that I already mentioned, and another paper by Jansson, Knut, and Lukács and Pittel. And this formula, so in our general setting of any alpha between 1 and 2 and any integer, positive integer S, if you take n equal to 0, so it is the first marginal, it is the kernel, it gives the distribution of the kernel. Okay. So this result is obtained by carefully analyzing the result by Conchon-Kergeon, by Guillaume and Christina, and so that their construction via Sin-Levy processes of their stable graph. So we have the distribution of the discrete Ah, sorry. Okay. So we have the distribution of, so of the discrete marginal. We can complete this. It's quite natural. When we define the kernel, we kept the root in its definition. And well, in some work, notably on some work on the Brownian graph, people usually remove the root and the adjacent edge. So our formula remains valid if, in our definition of the kernel, we erase the root and the adjacent edge, okay? And we still have this the same distribution for this graph. Okay, so here I just illustrate some particular example when alpha is equal to 5/4 and, sorry, yes. So two cases, alpha is equal to 5/4 and alpha is equal to 2. So in each case, well, I computed the different quantities that are involved in the formula. So the number of self-loop of multiple edge of symmetry and so on. And the corresponding product of weight when alpha is equal to 5/4 and alpha equal to 2. And from this, we obtain the distribution of the kernel in the two cases. Okay. So in the Brownian case, when alpha equal 2, you observe that you can uniquely obtain a graph where the internal vertices have degree 3. And this is can be read on our formula by noticing that when alpha equal 2, in the definition of the weight W, well, you can see that WK is equal to 0 for K larger than 3 because we have 2 minus alpha in its definition. So it's 0 for alpha equal 2. Okay. So there is an interesting observation we can do when we have this this distribution of these discrete marginals. Is that the formula we obtain resembles to the distribution of the configuration model. So I don't think that Christina gave it, I don't remember, but the distribution of the configuration model is well known and we can observe that, that there is a connection. So actually to be a bit more precise, if we take our nth marginal G and S condition on having M vertices, when M here is an integer larger than n plus 1. Well, it is distributed as a particular configuration model on M vertices, label 0 to M minus 1, with IID degree d alpha, where the degree are explicit there and constructed. They depend both on alpha and on the weight W that we have. So we take this configuration model and we condition it to be on our set of MNS, which is a set, remember, of connected graph with n plus 1 labeled leaves and surplus S and no vertices of degree 2. Okay, and we forget the labeling of the vertices which are not leaves. So in some sense, this distribution d alpha is a kind of a canonical, gives a canonical model, and you can check that it satisfies our initial distribution. The second moment is finite, and it's indeed in the evitated in the sense that we have described. So the associated configuration model and the associated uniform graph with IID degree will converge to the alpha stable graph in this case. Okay, so we have the one-dimensional distribution of this discrete marginal, and we can in fact obtain their link distribution by noticing that they can be constructed according to an algorithmic construction, which I will present now. It's very simple. This construction was first introduced by Philip Marshall to construct recursively the marginal of the alpha stable tree. And so we have something similar here to construct the discrete marginal of the alpha stable graph. So let me first just give the step in the the algorithmic construction. So if we start from a graph G, so in our set MSN, so we surplus S and N plus one label leaves. So we have such a graph. So take, for example, the one in the picture, G in M23. And to each, then we give some weight both to the edges and to the internal vertices of the graph. And the rule is the following. We give a weight alpha minus one to each edge and a weight, the degree of the vertice minus one minus alpha to each internal vertex. Okay. So we can check that the total weight is always deterministic. And then once we have given these weights, we pick one edge or one vertex with a probability associated to its weight. Okay. If we have picked a vertex, we add a new edge leaf. So see on the picture there where I add a new edge leaf with label fourth. In general, we add a new edge leaf with label n plus one. And if we have picked an edge, we split this edge in two, in some sense, and we glue on it a new edge leaf also with label n plus one. And we now, if we start, okay, so that's what I said before. Philippe Marchab proposed this to construct recursively the marginal of the stable tree. So to do this construction, he started from a tree which is composed of a unique edge. And he built it, he performed this algorithm recursively and obtained the marginal of the alpha stable tree. And so here, if we do the same, but starting from the kernel, the discrete kernel, and we do the same, we will obtain the joint distribution of our discrete marginal. Okay, so I stated this result a bit differently here, and saying that our sequence of discrete marginal is Markovian, with transition given by the step of this algorithm. And this property will be very useful to obtain further property on our connected alpha stable graph GS. Okay. Let me just here do a small parenthèse that will be useful also for the next property that I will settle. From this discrete marginal, we can reobtain the continuous graph or trees as scaling limit. The interesting thing that is new here in the first theorem that I mentioned. So if you take the discrete marginal of the alpha stable tree, so it is distributed as a particular Galton-Watson tree condition to have n vertices. And from Aldous and Duquesne result, we know that they converge in the scaling limit to the alpha stable tree. But actually here, it's a particular version of this Galton-Watson tree, since we have a joint distribution, it's the discrete marginal, and we can prove that the convergence actually holds almost surely. Okay. And similarly, for the alpha stable graph, I mean for a normalized connected component, if you pick, if you consider so this jointly built discrete marginal, rescaled by n to the power 1 minus 1 over alpha, it will converge almost surely to your graph up to a scaling constant, which is alpha. Okay. So this almost sure convergence, together with our description of the distribution of the discrete marginal and the algorithmic construction, will give us, very interesting information on the limiting graph GS. Let me just check. Okay. So I have listed three consequences. The first one is that we will get from this the distribution of the continuous marginal. Okay. So the continuous marginal, their distribution, is clearly given by first the distribution of the discrete marginal, which we have already talked about, and together with the distribution of the length of the edges of this discrete marginal. Okay, the continuous marginal is a discrete one plus length of the edge. And the distribution of this edge is the following. So given that we know that the discrete marginal has k edges, the lengths are have an exchangeable distribution, which is given by this product. So let's start by the end. The Dirichlet 1111 distribution here is a uniform distribution of the simplex of dimension k minus 1. And we multiplied this uniform distribution by a scaling factor, which is random, which is so the random variables that are listed here are all independent. So we multiplied it by a beta distribution with some parameters that depend on both on S, N, and K, the number of edges, and by a Mittag-Leffler distribution. And let me recall what is this Mittag-Leffler distribution. So all of these distributions that are involved here, the three of them, are connected to models of to scaling limits of Jørn's model. Okay. I won't go completely in details, but where are the Jørn's in our scheme? The Jørn's you can get them from the algorithmic construction. Okay, if at the beginning you start with a graph and you put some color on the edge, imagine each edge has different colors, and each time you add a new edge, it will increase the weight of this color. You have some Jørn models that are involved there. So it is well known, for example, that the Dirichlet distribution arrives at the scaling limits of Polya Jørn's model. Okay, and so the Mittag-Leffler distribution also arrives at scaling limit of an Jørn model. So I have recalled here this result because it's less, it's not as well known as the Polya Jørn model. So the Mittag-Leffler distribution depends on two parameters, we will call theta and beta, that are strictly positive. And if we start with a Jørn model, an Jørn model with two colors, say blue and red, with weight zero on blue and theta over beta on red, and you follow the following rules, each time you pick, so you pick a color with a probability proportional to its weight. If the picked color is blue, you add a weight 1 over beta to the blue color. And if it's red, you add a weight 1 over beta minus 1 to the blue color. So it's also increased the blue one and 1 to the red one. And with this scheme, Janssen proved that the total red weight rescaled by n to the power beta converges almost surely to some random variable, which distribution is what we call the Mittag-Leffler distribution. So there are other definitions of this random variable, but this is one way to define it. Okay, so this is just to say that we have the distribution of the continuous marginal, which are given by the discrete distribution plus this edge length as a product of three random variables, three independent random variables. Okay. Second consequence, we can describe. So this graph is a bit. This slide is a bit scary, but I'll try to explain what is on there. The main result there is that we will describe our graph GS as a cyclic structure. So the cyclic structure now is known. It's the kernel, the continuous. Yes, I mean the kernel KS. We have its distribution on which we will glue rescaled alpha stable tree. So this slide gives the distribution of the scaling factor we have to apply on the alpha stable tree that we will glue on the kernel. So we start from the kernel Ks, And given that TS says K edges and K minus S internal vertices with a degree that we know, D1, etc., K minus S, we will take independently first a sequence M1, etc., and this is 2K minus, 2K minus S, which is given by this Dirichlet distribution. I recall below what is a general Dirichlet distribution on the simplex of dimension n minus 1 there. Okay, so we have this first weight m1, m2k minus s. Independently, we take another sequence of weight for each I, which is between 1 and k minus s. K minus s is a number of internal vertices, remember. For each I, we take a sequence delta ij, which is distributed according to a Poisson Dirichlet distribution with an explicit parameter. So at the end of the slide, I recalled what is a Poisson Dirichlet distribution. It's a distribution on the set of decreasing sequence, which are positive and with some one. And now we take independently a family of rescaled alpha stable tree, where the K first stable tree are rescaled according to the mass, say, M. Sorry, it's a bit complicated to state. And the other stable tree, TAJ, are distributed according to a multiplication of the mass M and the delta mass. Okay. So whatever. We have explicit scaling of the alpha stable tree. And once we have this alpha stable tree, we will glue them on our kernel Ks as follows. So we have the first K stable tree will be glued on the edges of Ks. So what does it mean to glue a tree on an edge? It means that in your tree, you pick two points uniformly at random, and you replace the edge in your graph Ks by the path between these two randomly picked points. Okay. And you keep the rest of the tree, and so you have glued the trees on the edge, if you want. So we do this on the K edges of Ks. And in parallel, we will glue on each vertex of Kx. So we have K minus S vertex. We will glue a group of stable tree, Taj. So there we have an infinite number of stable tree, which are the stable tree we have rescaled by using the product of the M I plus K delta. So we have there an explicit distribution of the graph GA as a collection of stable trees, rescaled stable trees, glued on its kernel KS. And we have explicitly the distribution of the kernel. So we have the distribution of the whole graph. Okay, so this is one first description of this limiting graph GS. We have a second one, which is a line breaking construction. So remember, this will be my last result that I will present. So remember the Aldous line breaking construction of the Brownian tree. So I won't recall it. We discussed about it before. So there it's quite easy because we start from a Poisson point process on R plus and glue segment from this Poisson point process. So for the stable graph, it will be a bit more complicated, but I hope you will follow me. So we want to do something similar. Start from a sequence of segments and glue them in order to obtain the graph GS. Okay, so to do this, we will build recursively a sequence of measure metric spaces, so denoted by HSN. They are measured, so we have measure on them, and the measure are denoted by eta n. And the construction holds as follows. I start from a Markov chain, which is asked to have the following property. So the Markov chains Rn, we want that it's n's coordinate as a distribution given by a certain Mittag-Leffler distribution. So there, both the n and the s intervene in the definition of the parameter of the Mittag-Leffler distribution. And we also want that the transition in the Markov chain are characterized by this relation Rn is equal to Rn plus 1 times an independent beta distribution with beta with explicit parameter also. Okay. So we can prove that such a Markov chain exists indeed by constructing it explicitly from product of beta distribution. Well, anyway, it exists and we start from it. And given this Markov chain, we will construct so our growing sequence of measure metric space Hn as follow. So we start with the first element of the sequence, H0s, eta 0. To build it, we start from the discrete kernel Ks. And we will, we will glue on it, not glue, but we'll add on it edge lengths, which are given by the product of the random variable RS from off Markov chains, times sequence, which is theta, which is distributed according to a given Dirichlet distribution. Okay. So these terms, so theta, in the sequence theta, we have 2k minus s element. We take the first k element, we multiply them by rs, and this gives us some edge lengths that we put on ks, and this gives us our starting set h0s. This is actually just the continuous kernel that we had before. And in parallel, we put some, we need a measure, eta zero. This measure will help us to choose the next point where we will glue next some segment. Okay, so this measure eta zero is given by the sum of the Lebesgue measure on our space H zero plus some Dirac measure on the vertices of the discrete kernel. And these Dirac measures are multiplied by some scaling constant, which are given by Rs times the other element of the Dirichlet distribution we have. So we have there continuous set H0 with a measure on it. And now we will, to construct the space H1, we will pick a vertex according to eta 0. Okay, so that's the next slide that explain how we will continue. So at each step, we pick a vertex on the present space according to the measure we have put on it. So the normalized measure, it's not a probability, we normalize it. And to this vertex we have picked, we add a new closed segment of length, which is given by the n plus, by the difference n plus, sorry, r n plus s. R n plus s plus 1 minus r n plus s, so the r are the element of the Markov chains, times another beta distribution which is independent. Okay, and once we have had this new segment, we have a new space h n plus 1, and we add on it a new measure eta n plus 1 by keeping the measure eta we add on Hn and adding both a new a weight to the new created vertex, I mean to the vertex we have to the vertex we have picked V. Okay, we add some weight plus the Lebesgue measure on the segment we have glued it. Okay, so it's a bit complicated, but we have an explicit construction from the kernel. We add a segment with random lengths in some way that gives us an increasing sequence of space Hn. And when you take the union of this space and its completion, you obtain a version of the normalized component of the alpha stable graph. And just to finish, this construction was the one we obtained with Christina for the alpha stable tree when you start from a closed segment with length R1. And thank you very much. I will stop there.
Thank you very much, Benedict, for this very informative talk. Are there comments or questions for Benedict?
So I see that there are questions in the chat. No?
No, there don't seem to be new questions in the chat. So I have two questions. I have one question about this Markov chain or N, which you defined.
Mm-hmm.
This confused me a bit because I mean, you're not saying what is Rn plus 1 given Rn, right? Because, or is the Bn also independent?
So you construct Rn from Rn plus 1 multiplied by an independent? Yes.
All the yes, but this is somehow in the other time direction, right?
Yes, yes.
So if you give me, I don't know, R infinity, I can run this Markov chain, but
yes, yes. So,
I mean, you're just claiming there exists a Markov chain which satisfies this.
Yes, yes. You can construct, I don't remember the details, but you can construct them from a product of a beta distribution.
I see. Yeah, okay. But yes. At this point, you're saying there is a Markov chain which and you can leave it with these beta distributions.
Yes, yes. Actually, this chain were used already. Well, so we used them with Christina in our work on the alpha trees, and it appears in different works. So they were known by some people working on. Well, I cannot explain exactly, but they appeared at different places. So they were they are already known, and we already knew that they exist when we did this work. Well, if you want, I can give you more precisely their construction, but just now I don't have in head the detail. I just remember that you construct them from a product of specific independent beta distributions that you rescale.
Yeah. And I have a more general question. You have... To both speakers, somehow this was nicely explained how if you start with this configuration model with IID degrees, you end up with this continuous limit object. And of course, if one looks at these random walk constructions, one thinks that this should also somehow be an attraction point of a whole class of models. And so what happens, for instance, if you start with a configuration model, but you take not IID degree sequence, but let's say some exchangeable degree sequence, would you expect to have the same limit object?
Okay, so that's a good question. So Christina, at the end of her talk, she mentioned that Bamidi, Dara, van der Hofstadt, Zen, and co-author obtained some result when you take the degree deterministically, actually.
Mm-hmm.
In some sense, it's a stronger result because they obtain the scaling limits with starting from deterministic degrees, and so you just have to randomize them to obtain this Guillaume and Christina's result. But The problem is that, in fact, we don't know how to obtain the result that Christina and Guillaume got from the result they get. I mean, the identity distribution is not clear. I think, I don't know, Christina, if there have been some change, but... So in your case, you have something for the exchangeable distribution that can come from their work, I think. But
more, I see.
More precisely, I don't know, maybe Christina can complete because she was more implied in this part of the job. So
yes, I mean, I agree. I think that probably under certain conditions, I mean, it's not going to work in full generality, but I expect that in the sort of setting that you're describing, there should be a scaling limit. It should be covered by the results of Barmedian and company. But under precisely which circumstances that's the same as ours and under which circumstances is different, I would struggle to be able to tell you at this point. And I think that there are still some things that are a little bit mysterious here.
Yeah, nice. So now there's another question in the chat. In terms of the distributions, would any connection to Bayesian aspects be possible? And is the present construction on finite or infinite dimensional level? You mentioned finite marginals.
Okay, I'm not sure I understand the question. So what do you mean?
Maybe the speaker can clarify or the question asker, I mean.
Thank you. Basically, you're talking about distributions on a graph, and in terms of distributions, naturally, it is possible to generalize to Bayesian aspects. Is there any possibility to use any Bayesian construction also here? Of course, this relates to more statistical aspects in a sense, but nevertheless, possibly interesting. And naturally, you mentioned these finite marginals in your talk. Is your construction on also on infinite dimensional level? Because distributions can actually be many types, parametric, non-parametric, and so on and so on. Thank you.
So actually, since we have the joint distribution of the marginal, we have the distribution of the whole sequence of marginals. I don't know if it's a response to your second question. To the first one, I'm sorry, I didn't really get what you mean by a Bayesian aspect.
Would anything change in terms, I mean, would it be possible to connect to some prior or posterior aspects on the graph? It's more related to statistics, but would anything change considering those aspects?
I don't know. I don't know. Sorry.
Okay, thanks. Thanks.
So if there are no further questions, I suggest that we unmute ourselves and give an applause to Benedict. So thanks to everyone for attending. Next week, there is a holiday in many European countries and we will not have seminar in 2 weeks. We continue with Pascal Meyer and Sarah Pennington, and we will send announcements as usual. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you very much for organizing.